Oh, all of a sudden I'm piloting a spaceship.
Hey crew, I've got the key to that 23 Mercedes-Benz EQE 350 4MATIC. It's quite the mouthful. We are going to take it for a drive, but first let's check out what looks on the inside and outside. The EQE bears a strong resemblance to its larger EQS sibling, including up here at the nose, where we have this blacked out brow, complete with tiny tri-stars surrounding a giant one in chrome. As standard, you get LED headlights. This one has the digital lights. They're LED projectors that can cast images onto the road. With the AMG line package, we get blacked out trim around the faux vents at the corners. There's chrome trim down low on the bumper. In profile, you get standard 19-inch wheels, but the AMG line upgrades us to 20s in this aerodynamic design. Kind of like them. They're wrapped in Bridgestone all-season tires, 255 section front and rear. You're not supposed to open the hood for any reason, so to add wiper fluid, they give you this slot right here. Look at that. There's chrome trim for the windows, accenting the door handles, and for that lower garnish. Stepping back to look at the profile, this part is really interesting to me because I really didn't like the jelly bean shape of the EQS, but this 3.5-inch shorter wheelbase on the EQE somehow works with the proportions to make it better looking. I'm not going to call it attractive, but it's definitely better looking. At the back, we have this LED tail light bar going across the rear. The AMG line adds a lip spoiler. There's 4MATIC badging and chrome treatment down low on the bumper. It's a very rounded shape. It's not going to do it for everyone. And though I do think it's improved on the EQS, it still stops short of enticing. Let's look at the interior though. To open the doors, you either press on the handles or hit the unlock button on the key fob and the door handles deploy. Looking inside at this two-tone interior of dove gray on light brown with light brown contrast stitching in this quilted pattern. The rear seats are heated on this model. There's leather up top with more contrast stitching, leatherette for the inserts, harder plastics down low, nice textured material on this armrest, one-touch up-down windows. A Burmester 3D sound system is standard. There are your heating controls. Stepping inside, just duck your head taller, folks. Behind my own seat at 6 feet tall, I've got just gobs of knee room, and the seat back is in leatherette, giant map pockets, good-sized foot pockets to slide my feet under, and astonishing thigh support considering the batteries are in the floor. There's a four-zone climate control here, this rose gold accent on the air vents. No drive shaft hump, just a little hump there to get over, but I can fit with headroom in the middle seat. And that of course means that I have headroom on the side seats as well. There's an armrest that comes down with two deploying cup holders and padding. With this secondary sunroof, we've got tons of light back here in addition to all this space. I love the two-tone, great features. Let's check out the front. Door close noise, nice solid thud, especially considering the frameless windows, which often rattle. Up front are some huge headrests, heated and ventilated chairs with three-position memory, four-way lumbar, you get aluminum illuminated tread plates, same brown formats as the back seats, same material quality on the front doors as the rear, but we add some more rose gold accents there. Power adjusting and power folding door mirrors, pull this lever to open the power-operated trunk. It is not a hatch-style opening like its larger EQS sibling, but there's still a fair amount of storage. And by pressing these buttons here, you can power send down the 40-20-40 split-folding rear seats. There's a power close and lock feature on the trunk lid, which comes down so rapidly. Drivers get a heated leather-wrapped steering wheel, excellent size and perfect thickness in the hands. You've got controls on the left-hand side for safety features and to reconfigure the digital instrument cluster. On the right-hand side, those operate the 12.8-inch OLED infotainment, which you'll note is not the optional 56-inch hyperscreen that covers the dash. Looks so futuristic, it's awesome. But honestly, I prefer this setup because you get to look at all this beautiful open pore wood trim and those cool turbine style air vents. Plus, this infotainment system is great on its own. It's intuitive, it's quick responding, it doesn't have complex menu structures. It also has wireless Apple CarPlay and Android Auto. Below the screen are drive mode settings and a fingerprint scanner where you can bring up a custom profile if you've set it up. Lots of gloss black here to collect dust, smudge, and scratch, but you can slide it forward to find a wireless smartphone charging pad. Got these fun activating cup holders, two USB-C ports, a spot for your key. Under the padded armrest, we find deep storage with another two USB-C ports. The storage continues under the console with that area and a strap to secure your cargo. Visibility is just kind of okay with thicker B and C pillars, but you do have standard blind spot monitoring with rear cross traffic. The exterior of the EQA may not have dazzled me, but this interior fully wins me over with all the different colors and materials, the technology, and the space. I'm ready. Let's take the EQA for a drive. All right, let's fire it up. The expanding ambient lighting, a little hum there on startup is pretty cool. For our drive mode, let's begin in comfort of our Eco Comfort Sport and individual options here. And then let's make sure that the sound experience is turned on. Yes, and we're looking at Silver Waves to start. Both this one and this one are offered on the EQS, but the Roaring Pulse, that's new for the EQE. Also, we've got the sound experience outside on, so the speakers are projecting the noise to anyone who may be nearby. They know you're so cool. Lifting up, well actually before that, let's check on the battery. We've got 88% charge and it's giving us an estimate of 303 miles, which would put us at around 340 total miles at 100% charge. That's better than a lot of people were expecting. They're expecting around 300 for the 350 4MATIC. Now, up into reverse, we've got some high resolution backup camera settings here, and we've got a wide angle, and this is my favorite one, make your own little shrunken universe. Just pan around the whole car. Back on out. Let's do a turning radius test. Oh my goodness. That is insane. We do have the available rear wheel steering system on this model. I don't know if it's the optional 4.5 degrees or 10 degrees because they didn't share the specs with me. Whatever it is, it helps maneuverability a ton. Turn signal sound. Gentle, I like that. World famous horn test is up next. Ooh, kind of harsh for a luxury vehicle. Cool, we can see the augmented reality turn by turn directions on the infotainment. For our regen braking, we have three settings. I just hit the strong setting, which is a solid one pedal driving experience. Didn't have to touch the brake until the very end. And without the creep setting turned on, oh, that's a setting, you can have a creep setting, then it doesn't roll the vehicle forward. So it stays stopped. The powertrain in the EQE 350 Plus is a rear motor setup, but in the 4MATIC, we've got two electric motors. Whichever way you go about it, they're paired with a 90.6 kilowatt hour battery pack.
The output is 288 horsepower and 391 pound-feet of torque, I believe. So a healthy amount of torque here. And like all electric vehicles, that's just delivered the moment you touch the throttle. But in the comfort profile, it's not touchy at all. It's so very graceful. And the roads around this Denver area should be a good test of this air suspension system with the adaptive dampers, because they're not great. Now, if I did need to touch the brakes, and just like that, this has turned into a rain drive. The skies have opened up and we gotta test out the windshield wipers on the EQE, which so far are doing a great job keeping the water off the windshield, as windshield wipers should. Now, the road has gotten a little twistier, so I want to go into the sport drive mode and see if the EQE doesn't wake up a bit. The steering has added some heft to the rack. Turning is quick. Communication through the wheel isn't incredible, but you can easily point the EQE through the curves. When you do have to stomp hard on the brakes, they're certainly not as smooth as they are when around town. The responsiveness isn't an immediate bite. It's nice having that regen braking do some of the initial slowing for you before a corner. And then the surge of torque out of the corner is entertaining. When that initial boost does fade, there isn't an overwhelming amount of power here. Remember, 288 horsepower. But it's plenty on a road like this, with the weight being so down low, even though there's 5,400 pounds of it, the low center of gravity helps the EQE corner flatly and gives you some confidence at the helm. More throttle is giving us more of that silver waves noise, which is just okay to my ears. I want more out of it, so maybe we should try Vivid Flux. Oh, all of a sudden I'm piloting a spaceship. And I kind of like it. I like that the noise happens not just under acceleration, but also under braking. That's pretty cool. And last to try as we enter the highway is Roaring Pulse. That is quite like a roar. Not what I just want to hear. Leave it at Vivid Flux. That's my vote. It's just weird. And I mean, if you're not going to have a V8 soundtrack, which this vehicle shouldn't even try to make, then have the sound be interesting. This is interesting and fun. It's either that or just, you know, turn it off completely. Like, don't have a sound experience and just coast. Now at highway speeds, the cabin has remained mellow. It's not silent, but it is mellow. And that's excellent for electric vehicles that don't have the natural NVH cancellation of an internal combustion motor. So you'd hear things like tire, wind, and road noise more. You hear them here, and this is not the best highway surface, but they do not disrupt the pleasant driving experience, and these seats are phenomenal. Just so ergonomically shaped, plush, supportive, and the ride quality is compliant. You jostle around a little bit, though not uncomfortably. Adaptive cruise control and a lane keep assist feature. Ooh, Veloster N. RIP. That's a good noise. And it's holding the EQE perfectly in the center of the lane. After I've done my passing and I want to move over lanes, indicate right. If it spots an opening, it will change lanes for me. And do so just as smooth as I would have done myself. All right, cool down, wipers. Even though the road is slick and it's hard to spot those lane markings, the system does a great job doing so. It does make me check in on the wheel every 30 seconds or so. It's not truly hands-free. But in terms of reducing driver fatigue, we've got it covered. And while we are coasting on the highway, if I hit the right paddle enough, I'll go to the no recuperation setting. In other words, a glide setting. So when I take my foot off the throttle, we just absolutely coast. And I do love when electric vehicles have this, the option to fully defeat regen braking for applications just like this. And a rainbow! It's a perfect way to start to wrap up my POV first drive of the Mercedes-Benz EQE 350 4MATIC. And with that, let's go into the Eco drive mode as we face a bit of traffic. A couple things I've yet to share with you. The top speed, should it concern you, is 130 miles per hour, and the charge rate, it probably will concern you. From a DC fast charger, you can go from 10 to 80% in about 31 minutes, or go from 10 to 100% from a level 2 charger in around 9.5 hours. Now, because I've only had a few hours with the EQE 350, this is a true and proper first drive, I'm not going to reach a verdict on this car, whether it's better than its EV alternatives. I will, however, paint a picture for you. So the EQE is kind of an in-betweener vehicle. It's bigger than something like the BMW i4, but smaller than something like a Tesla Model S or Lucid Air. And the price point, they haven't announced it yet, but we're expecting it to be about $70,000, which would make it more expensive than the i4 eDrive 40, but considerably less expensive than the Tesla Model S and Lucid Air. The range, again, we don't have an EPA estimate at this point, but we've dropped 12% and we've covered a really fair distance while also tackling some aggressive driving on some fun roads. The performance is solid. The interior is spacious, has beautiful materials. I love the technology. How cool have these ambient lights been this entire time, by the way? And, you know, it's not the best looking on the exterior. That I do have to give to its alternatives. There are better looking cars out there. If you can get around that, quite a lot going on here. I think this is a much better play from Mercedes-Benz than the EQS. Hope you guys have enjoyed this POV first drive. If you've enjoyed this video, please like, comment, and share it. Subscribe to the channel, hit that bell to get notified, and I'll see you next time.